Okay. So first of all, we would like to understand that what we are going to learn in this entire journey for JSP Servlet. So we are basically going to learn servlets and JSP. So the difference between whatever you have learned till thus far, that was core Java, and it has that knowledge will be taken into servlets. But we are coming into a separate architecture. It is called the enterprise architecture. Okay, that is, we are not restricted to standalone Java. That is, we are writing something with a main function. We are entering the main function, which is the point of entry or execution. And then we are running the Java code through a compiler and runtime. Here, the entire architecture is based on the web. That is, we are starting to learn about web development. That is, if we want to use not a standalone thing, but a client-server architecture where the client will send a request to a server, where the server will receive the request, process the request, and provide the response back to the client. And the client here is the user. You are the client. Or the application is the client. Application is not the client. Application is having both the client and the server. But the entire web architecture, here one is the client, whether the end user or the user. And there is someone sitting on the web, some application server, some web server, which is not local to your PC. Your PC is only having a browser. So it is sufficient that you do not have to have a client. And you also do not like in a standalone, you do not have to have other application, the server. Basically, the server is within the client. It is not like that. Somewhere else, the server waits there. But here, the entire thing we are going to understand through a diagram. That is, we are going to not even a thin client architecture. That is, earlier it was a thin client and a server, client-server architecture. It is not even like that, because that was also not over a web. Here, that client and server architecture was initially was restricted over a LAN. LAN means within a local network, peer-to-peer networking. So in an office, you would be having one or two servers, and you will have all the client software loaded into each and every in every laptop or your desktop, and each of these laptops and desktops will be connected through a LAN network, local area network. That is, it will be restricted to a very local domain. But that was fine within the organization. That was something which was happening. It was catering to a bit of larger population than your local domain. But there was a necessity whenever the customer, the corporates becoming global. That means your office is not in Kolkata only. It is not even in India, in Delhi and Bombay and some other places, but it is all spread over in the globe. So in this case, whether you have a lease line or something, it's a costly affair to have a networking with all the offices all over the world. So there was a consortium that was WWW, the Worldwide Consortium for Web. They decided that we have to have only a web or internet through which we will propagate the application. That is, the application is available somewhere on the net, and through your browser only. You need to have a laptop or a desktop with only one browser. That is all you need to have, whether it's a Internet Explorer or a Chrome browser or a Firefox, whatever. Any browser will do. So, and that will help you to communicate over the net and can access the application, which might be residing over a server in the web. To simulate that locally, because we are just learning, okay? So we need not have to, and the beauty of Java is that you can simulate the entire thing, that client server architecture or a wave architecture, over into your laptop or desktop. You do not need to have something over cloud right at this moment. You can develop the prototype entirely over in your local domain, as if you are doing it on the browser, on the web. So just while you deploy it, you just deploy it over the net. That is all you can do. But the entire thing will work because it is following some guideline. And that servlet, that enterprise architecture for Java, Java EE, what we say as Java EE. Can you see this? Java EE. This is called the perspective. Till now, you were working with Java perspective, which is a standalone perspective of Java, Java core. But now if you see my cursor, the mouse, can you see my mouse? And when I go, this is an Eclipse editor. You have already used Eclipse. And there is, because you have installed Eclipse Enterprise version edition. Okay. So you have this enterprise edition of Java as well. That is, the perspective is also installed. And why we need a Java enterprise edition? Because we are going to not restrict our development only in standalone. We are going to now develop something on the web. For that, we need some HTML knowledge. I hope that is with you, because that is the HTML thing. That is the page through which you will send the request to the server. And on the server, there is a sublet. Let us see that through a diagram. Can you see this diagram?
Yes.
Okay. So let us introduce you to sublet. Don't worry about JSP right now. JSP we will learn at the very end. But what is important, because you have learned Java, you will be interested to learn the sublet part, understand how you are going to use your Java knowledge in form of a sublet. And then as a client, here you see, this is the client. Can I go here? Yeah. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Here we have a client, right? What is a client? The client is nothing but your browser or your laptop or your desktop, or you are the client. Fine. You are saying that I am a user. I'm going to request something such that I will display it over my browser, that page. So I'm sending a request to somewhere on this server. This server is residing not it at your house or in your laptop. For the timing, yes, you understand that your server, that whatever server that you have done, is inside your laptop. You have installed that. But forget about that. You are just talking about the architecture, whether it is within your laptop or your desktop, or it is on the web somewhere else. We are not coming to that discussion. We are saying that you have a client, which is a simple browser, HTML browser, through which you are sending a request through a page called HTML page, which contains the request. And that request goes to a server, because you have said that you have specified on the browser a URL, isn't it? Some URL you have given, that you are sending a request to the URL, to the server, and the server is with some IP address. Okay. IP address means where the host, the host. It can be a Unix server or it can be a Windows server, doesn't matter. but it is just a host. That is, you are sending a request to the server through an IP address, and that address is going to use, that server is going to use a port. Let's say there is a port here which will accept your request, or the port is called the service. Okay. And that service will open the gate for you. That is, that service knows that I'm receiving a request from the client, which has sent a request through an HTML page. So I will process the page. What will it do? The service port, or let's say some application port is there, it will direct that request into where? Into a helper application. And that helper application of that server is nothing but a web container. Is nothing but a web container. What is that web container? It can be any web application server. It is a server which will try to process your request, give you the service. And one of the very popular servers or web containers, we will better say web container. The server is hosting that web container. Server is a physical device. That server is residing either you are in Kolkata, maybe in a different Kolkata data center, or maybe this server is in the data center of Bombay, or maybe this data center is, you are a global company, and your company headquartered is in US, in New York, let's say. So this server, physical server, is residing on the New York server, on the New York. And this, whenever you are sending a request, you are sending the server address, that IP address. That IP address knows that this server is there in New York. And this server, you are hitting the web container, which is already installed within that server. And that web container is Tomcat. There can be other web servers as well, but let's say we are learning about Tomcat. The question of learning Tomcat is out of scope. We are here learning about servlets, JSPs. But we need to have some idea of what a server and what it does. We will learn that. So for the timing, just say that there is a server residing either locally in your machine, or maybe it is in a separate location, not within your laptop or desktop. So that is a separate server, and that server will be denoted by the IP address. So this server is hosting a web container called Tomcat, which is the helper application. So that Tomcat will have a service port. Let's say for this case, it is 8080. Whenever you are installing Tomcat, you will be configuring that service port as 8080 by default. You might give it some other value, but that is different. So through that 8080 port, you are asking for a service to process this request. This request is an object. We will know about that. That request hits the server web container Tomcat through the port 8080, and thereafter Tomcat will try to process this. Now, whenever you say that I have mentioned a particular page, requested a page, and that page is already deciding on the server. In that case, I do not need any servlet, because that page is already deciding. We have already kept that page onto the server. That is through some HTML. Yeah, we have developed an HTML page, and we have kept that page onto the server in a particular folder. And that folder is also known to the web container Tomcat. So it finds that a particular index.html is already there. Or maybe you have sent a request abc.html, and you are having that abc.html over on the server. So that is called a static page. But that was very initial beginning. That is a description of the company or how, what does the company do. Everything is predefined, pre-designed. So those pages are called the static pages. So you can request one of those pages through a request. That is also a request. And it will go to the server. Tomcat knows that you are asking because you have asked for abc.html. And Tomcat knows that I have this abc.html stored in some place. So it will just pick up that page. It will pick up that page and process it. It will send the response back to the client as an HTML page or a JSON page, okay, or an XML page, and that page will be decoded over onto the client browser. So the browser, like the JavaScript within the client, will know that how to receive that and how to process that response HTML page over into your client. That is, you will see that page displayed on your screen. Suppose you wanted to understand the Google page. You have written a request, URL request to the server where the Google, that page is residing. So exactly that page will be responded back to you through the web container or whichever web container is there on the server, which hosts Google. There is one very important, now, not always that you need a static HTML page or static page, because otherwise your requirement is not fulfilled, because 99% of the time the people using the web server or the web application will require some new page, some dynamic page, right? That is why you are doing a web development. That is, you are not, then a particular class 10 past student can also write a HTML page and put it as a static page. So you can design your website, but your website is only dynamic, only useful when it is dynamic. So this web server should cater to, should give you the response back with some new values, some dynamic values in form of HTML page, HTML5 page, or you can have your JSON page or whatever. But whatever the client sees was different from what it has requested earlier. So that is called a dynamic page, because my query can change. It is not a static query. My query is dynamic. So for that, I need someone to be residing over here in that server, aided, that is this servlet, that is called a servlet. That is called a servlet. Like you had that applet, instead of applet, we are using a servlet, because applets are no longer used. We are using servlet because it is more dynamic and it is more versatile. This servlet can be hosted within the web container. It is hosted within the web container. So when the service request comes for a dynamic page, what it does, 8080 will forward that request to web container Tomcat. Okay. And that web container will now ask the servlet to process that request. And you are actually asking that servlet service through some mechanism that we will discuss. So servlet is called into picture. Servlet will service that request. Servlet will produce the response. And this response goes to the client. So the entire process becomes atomic. So some request has been done. Someone has processed this request. And that request goes back to the client. So the entire cycle is atomic. So any request cannot be in a state where it does not go back. See, a request can be successfully responded or can be unsuccessfully responded. So whatever, whether it's a success or failure, it has to come back to the client. The response can be a dynamic page for a success, or it could be a failure, some 404 error, page not found. This is also a response back to the client, isn't it? You might have got so many things. You have been using Wake for so many years now. Okay, so you sometimes get successfully all the pages displayed, or sometimes you might get a 404 error, isn't it? That page not found. Your network is not available, so you are not being able to see the page which you have requested. One very important thing within the web container is the deployment descriptor. Without the deployment descriptor, that is web.xml within the web apps folder, you will not be able to use the service of the servlet. So this is a descriptor, deployment descriptor. So sometimes you are asking for the service, not always, but whenever you are requesting the help of a servlet for a dynamic response, you are mentioning within the URL, within this request, that you want to have some function to be catered, to be serviced from a servlet. And that request or that particular description should be defined somewhere. Otherwise, how will Tomcat know that you are asking for a particular service or a particular servlet? Is it possible? Think of a situation where you are asking the server to give you help of this, but it is not that you are thinking you are only the using the server. You are only the user of this, one single user of this entire server. Is it possible? There will be hundreds and thousands of users using the server. You do not know. You think that your client, your request is being serviced by the sublet or the server. But there are hundreds of clients, and maybe one application you are, because hundreds of clients are using one application, only one application, but that one application will have so many functions, so many services. And each of these service is requested by some page, separate pages, asking for different sublet services. So if you do not describe each and every service provided by the servlets, by the Java code deciding on the server, how will you let the Tomcat know that this particular request is asking for this particular service? Is it possible? Think of till this time you were only using one application and one server, which was the Java standalone. So there were not, lots of people were not using it. It is only one user using it and getting the response or whatever the output. That is basically a batch processing you are doing through the Java. So that is fine. Till now, whatever you have learned in Java is basically you will be using in batch processing, huge chunk of data to be processed. Yeah, you will do that. We have not learned JDBC. We will learn that JDBC in this context. We could have learned JDBC immediately after Java, but I preferred to let you introduce into servlets and JSP, and then we will go into JDBC, because then you will understand that Java you are using in servlets, JSP you will be using a combination of JSP and HTML. So that part, which is the presentation layer, Java and the sublet is the backend layer, and the database layer will be separate in a database container or a database like MySQL. But that servlet will go and talk to that database through some connection, and that is JDBC. So entire picture you will get up. That is better instead of going in pieces. Okay, that's why. You agree, no? This is the best way to learn about the entire picture. Now, that deployment descriptor, web.xml, is one of the important things, one of the most important things. If you understand this one, you will understand servlets and JSP. Okay, any questions till now?
No, sir.
So Aishwarya, you are clear, right? What about Shraddha, Rajshekar, Kundan, Deep, Ashish? Are you following or you are not?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am following.
Yes,
Okay,
sir. I
good.
said that case.
Maybe these are the things that is already you already know because you are already aware of JSP and sublet technology, but still better to have a revision. So we are going to this. So I understand, I think you have understood this technology, this architecture. The client and the server with the servlet hold or hosted within the Tomcat or which is the web container. There is a web XML, which is called the deployment descriptor. Because other without these descriptors, we will not be able to deploy the response back to the client. That is why it is called deployment descriptor. Okay, very good. Now just I will go through this, what I have written. You know how servlet works. Client sends a request to the server. Server sends back the data in response in HTML or JSON format to the client. That is fine. That is a simple way. The request could be static or dynamic, as we have described. For static page, the server already has the page. So you are requesting for a static page, you can directly get it because you know that I know that there is one page which is already stored in a particular server. So fine, you know the server IP address and you are asking for that page. Fine, that is called a static page. But at the same time, dynamic page, the server does not have it. So a dynamic page, a server will be not having, but it has to build it through the servlet in the runtime using the deployment descriptor. Needs to be built it at the runtime. Server takes the help of a helper application known as web container because it has to receive the request has to be received by the web container, and the web container will consult the web XML and then it will call the servlet, which can service this request. Part of the entire thing is a part of an application. So you have already built the servlets where it will be catering to the dynamic service request. That's all. The servlet will process the request by fetching data. The servlet will process the request by fetching data, preparing the data for presenting to the client in form of HTML page or JSON. Web containers are Apache. Okay, so this one, Tomcat, is from the Apache group of applications. Apache has a lot of applications. Apache is one of the organizations which has also one very important application, which is called web container or web server. So it is called Apache Tomcat. There is also called JBoss. There is also Glassfish. And you can also have IBM WebSphere. So all these are application servers or web servers. Better to say web servers. These are app servers. These are app servers which also have features of web servers. Web servers, whenever we say this app server is a web server, what we say basically say that we have objects like requests and responses. That is all about web servers. Web servers are nothing but app servers, but additionally having requests and responses. And the entire game is with request and response. That's all. If you can understand requests, what is requests and responses through HTTP servlet, you are done with web development. Understanding at least the architecture. Now, in this particular example, the web container in this case is Tomcat, finds abc.html. That abc.html is to be built dynamically, so it will call servlet, a Java program. Okay? That is, the request is diverted by Tomcat to servlet. Now the request goes from the Tomcat, it knows to the web deployment descriptor which servlet it has to call. So it will call that particular sublet. And once that sublet is called, it will understand that it can process this request dynamically. When a request calls abc.html, a page which should be getting called is servlet through Tomcat. Inside the container, there is a special file called web.xml. We have learned about this, called deployment descriptor, in which we mention for which request which servlet is called. Okay? We will see that when we start the examples. In web.xml, and what is there in the web.xml? We will see, but just to understand, right, in this, for this discussion. In the web.xml, we will have two tags. Tags means HTML tags. I understand you already know about tags. One is called the sublet tag, and the other is called sublet mapping tag. Okay? Sublet tag mentions the class name. That is a sublet name. Class name. And sublet mapping tag mentions the URL mapping. So how will you access this sublet? That mapping is called the URL mapping, and that is defined in the sublet mapping. So combination of sublet and sublet mapping tags will actually be defined in web.xml and will actually pinpoint to that particular sublet that you are asking for to service this request. And what is sublet? Sublet is a normal class, plain old Java object. You must have heard this term. Like, you have already learned about the normal classes that you have learned in Java sessions. Those are called plain old Java object. The way you access a class through the packages and everything. Now, the same POJO, plain old Java object, will extend HTTP sublet class. You know, extend means inherits. And this HTTP sublet class is provided by the Tomcat, the web server. So the web server has given you two objects through this HTTP sublet class. One is the request and the other one is the response. You do not have to create any request and response object, because that is being provided by the HTTP sublet class in the Tomcat container, or Tomcat web container, or maybe JBoss or Glassfish or IBM WebSphere. All of these web servers will provide you with the HTTP sublet class. So knowing only HTTP sublet class is enough for you to develop sublets. Got it? This HTTP sublet gives all the features you need for a web development, for a web application. Okay? So not very complicated. It's very simple. If you can understand the basics, if you can understand the architecture, you do not start away writing code, then you will never learn the subject. You have to understand from the very fundamentals. If you understand, I always give stress to learning the fundamentals. One who has learned the fundamentals well, in your long career as an IT specialist or IT programmer, you will benefit. Nobody can take away that knowledge that you have gained, because you have a clear understanding of the fundamentals. Then writing code is very simple. Otherwise, you will find it always very difficult. Everything, even the simple things, you will find it difficult because your concept, your fundamentals are not clear. Okay. Response object built by, so if you follow these classes minutely and if you practice at home, I'm sure you will be a champion of JSP sublets. Like you are a champion right now for Java and JSP and JavaScript. Just follow, give some patience, give some time into it, practice it. You will surely there won't be any problems. And response object is, again, a response object is out of this HTTP sublet class. Response object built by sublet goes to client. Response object comes to the client. request goes away from the client to the server, and the response comes from the server to the client, towards the client. Response object billed by the servlet. Now the servlet has billed the response object. Goes to the client in form of XML or JSON. Okay. But always, like for a, as a developer, you might hate XML, because XML, you have to go through each and every details, and it is very, very cumbersome, very difficult. Not difficult, I mean, it is cumbersome to go through the big XML, because the XML output is just very simple. But for that, you have so many tags in a XML. So just displaying for a simple thing. So there is someone who is sitting to avoid XML response servlet. Version 3 provides annotations like web servlet. We will understand that annotation. You know annotation. This annotation talks a lot of things, tells you about a lot of things. You do not have to write a huge code. That one single line of annotation can do a lot of things. So an XML called abc.xml will be converted to abc.html through that web servlet annotation. And that is provided by servlet. So whenever servlet will send it back to client, servlet will get a XML response, will create an XML object, but it will know how to convert that XML into an HTML. You just have to mention this annotation. That's all. Okay. Any questions? This is a very important topic. Important page. Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay, can I come back to the Eclipse? Are you being able to see that the screen?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So we have just got an idea of a servlet. Not only servlet, we have got an idea of the client, the server, the web, the Tomcat, the web server, as well as your deployment descriptor, which is web.xml. You have learned, you have used a lot of web.xml, and you have done a lot of things. But right now we have seen that what is an web.xml. It is called a deployment descriptor. That is very important to configure. It's a sort of a configuration tool through which the servlet knows, or the Tomcat knows, which service is serviced by which servlet. Okay. Now, let us say we will go to the page number 2. What is page number 2? We will see that we have to set the Eclipse. I think already now you have set the Eclipse Enterprise Edition. Okay, let's say there can be very good IDEs, like IDEs means integrated development environments, where you have the editor, where you can have the context sensitive helps with a dot. You will get a lot of help. You do not have to write everything like in Notepad. Unlike Notepad or any other text editor, you have to write lines and lines of code, and you have to know each and everything. You have to consult the document. But here, you do not have to consult the document, because the document is inbuilt within that editor. So if you are running a Java or a servlet. So servlet is inbuilt within that editor, and you have the documentation as well. So you will, whenever you say something like HTTP servlet, so whatever HTTP servlet, whatever the response, all these things will be automatically, you will get a help out of it. So there are very good editors where it can help you in editing, where it can help you in writing codes, big codes, with annotations, with explanation of annotations, with explanation of each and every line of code. You can access the classes. You can have the jar files. You can import the jar files from external sources. so many things. You can do it in one place only. You do not have to go to separate places. And there are, and also you can save it, you can compile it, you can run it, you can build it, you can do whatever. You can get the output over in the same terminal, or you can, for a web, you can directly invoke the web browser and see your output. That's all. So everything is done by the IDEs, and very good IDEs are Eclipse IDEs, NetBeans, IntelliJ is one of the finest IDEs. But it is fine if everything can be done over Eclipse IDE as well. For Eclipse, you need to download the Eclipse. You go to Google and search for Eclipse download, and you will find that Eclipse IDE for Java EE. Just go for Java EE, Java Enterprise Edition, for that Eclipse IDE. Otherwise, you will just only get the Java core, not the servlet, not the JSP and other things. You will not be able to use the Eclipse for developing web applications. Okay? There will be download links. You select Windows 64. I think everyone will have the Windows 64 bit. Download the zip file. Select a workspace. Workspace is a folder. It will ask for a workspace. You can decide where your workspace or wherever you are building the projects, and project details will be stored there. So all these thing inputs you have to give. And I think you have already done that. You already know how to download and install Java Eclipse IDE for Java EE. You have to mention where you want the workspace. So you, for a servlet, you can mention servlet, that all the servlet functionalities or the workspace for the all the servlet details will be there stored in under the servlet folder of D Devashish workspace servlet. It is, I have given that thing. Now inside Eclipse, you will have one output space where you have several tabs like markers, properties, servers, data source explorer, snippets. Let me go to the, can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Eclipse screen, fine. Can you see that the window is divided into two partitions? One where you code, this is the editor part. This part is the editor part where you write the code. And this part is where, this is the output part, path. Okay, where you have markers. Like sometimes this marker tab will help you whenever you are writing code, whenever you do some mistakes, you will see that it will give you a details of all the problems that you are having. Okay, so you can consult the markers tab. There is a properties tab. I'm just using an editor where I've just written some text. It is not a code. So it will not be displayed anything over here, properties. But here you can always go to file and you can see the properties. See, whenever I went to a project like this, I clicked on here. Immediately the properties tab, the tag, properties tab has all the information. Like this is the location of the project or this particular file, that JSP and servlet codes roadmap. This is deciding over this. So all these things are there, all the information, properties. Servers, it's a very important part. We will learn that. What is server? That is the Tomcat server that we are using as a web server. Now, right now, the Tomcat server, we have not started it. So this information is available over servers. Another one is Data Source Explorer. Now, database connections and all this, we are not done any database JDBC over here. So there is no, you will get this one empty. Snippets. Snippets are the JSP snippets. Like, what does this do? There's a lot of noise. So we will come to snippets when we will learn. We will learn JSP. We will not waste our time over this. So snippets will have all the JSP snippets. Console. Console is the part like in the when we were learning JavaScript or Java, you had an output window where you will get all the outputs. Here in Java, you had the output directly. You are writing system.out.println, and whatever the output is being displayed over here, that output terminal. But here you are using a console because as if this is the console is the background, the backend, and whatever output is there on the browser. Like the browser, you can have, I have selected the default system web. I have not selected default system web browser. Otherwise, whatever output you will be getting for out of that sublet processing will be displayed over in this page. I have used an external browser, which is Firefox. It is better to understand that way. Or you can use Internet Explorer or Microsoft Edge or Chrome, anything. So console, like whenever you start the server, whatever will be displayed, like if I start here, the server, I say start. Oh, because the server part is not yet invoked. I have not invoked it. We will come to know. So immediately, whenever you start this, all the backend exam the log outputs will be displayed on the console. That whether your server has been started correctly or not, everything. Correct. So what we have learned is that the markers will give you an indication of any problems or any issues that Java compiler is, or the JSP or Java compiler is, any error messages or warnings or whatever will be displayed over here. You can consult this markers tab. Properties tab, you have known. Servers is the Tomcat server. Data source explorer is the database connections and whatever details. Snippets is for JSP. And the last one is the select Java ES perspective. Now you do not have to select it. I've just written it just to explain you. You do not have to select it. What you do is depending on your project. Now this is a web project. So immediately once you create a web project, this will be selected. The perspective will be Java Enterprise Edition. Okay. It is no longer Java. You do not have to do it, but just be aware that now, because you are developing not a Java core application, it is a web server application or a web application. You are actually using a perspective of Java EE, Enterprise Edition. So all the compilation type compilation and the libraries, all will be through Java EE perspective. Any questions? My question to you is, how many of you, I hope all of you have installed the Java, the JSP, not the JSP, that Eclipse editor for JEE, Java Enterprise Edition, right? Everyone has done that. Now we will see that you need to install Tomcat. I think because you are already into Java and development, so you have also installed Tomcat in your local server. Let's see page number 3. Configure Tomcat in Eclipse. First of all, this Tomcat is not available directly over Eclipse. But Eclipse, you have to install Tomcat and configure it over Eclipse such that you can use the Tomcat web server. How? First of all, go to any browser, either it's a Google browser, Chrome browser, or a Firefox or Internet Explorer. You go there, use type in Tomcat download. Then select Apache Tomcat. And Apache Tomcat 8 software download. At least download Apache. There is also 9. But it is fine if you say Apache Tomcat 8. You download it. Select version 8.0.48. Okay, it is fine. It's the latest version. And for 64-bit Windows. Also, you need to install the source code distribution zip. Two things. One is a 64-bit Windows zip for Tomcat 8.0.48. And of course, you do not forget to install the source code distribution zip as well. Because that is the documentation. And without documentation, it's difficult. So always do that. Now, once you install Tomcat the first time, let's say you have installed Tomcat first time. You have done that. Its installation is very simple. Like any installation, it is very simple. You go to next, and you always mention which particular folder you want to install Tomcat for, because that information is needed by you when you try to configure Tomcat in Eclipse. Okay, once Tomcat is downloaded, there is a link in the server tab to create a new server. Let me show you. So you have this Eclipse. Okay. Let's say you do not have this over here. You do not have this over here. Tomcat server, what you do not know. This is the first time you have installed Tomcat. Fine. Since I have already configured, that's why you are getting it. So you go to Windows. So if you do not see that server, this tab over in this output window, you go to show view. And show view, you say servers. So immediately you will get one tab over here. Okay, this one. But if you already have this, fine. So what you do next is, you go here. Then once you have done this servers, you will see that there is a servers folder. Okay. You can go to new. And go to other. You can use this one, server. You say next, and then you come to finish. But at one point of time, you will ask where your Tomcat server is installed. So you just have to mention server. If you have any problems in installing, like first of all, you can always get this server over here. But if you do not have, go to show view and go to servers. You will find that this is highlighted. It is there. Suppose you did not have this. Okay. There is no servers here. I have removed it. You just go to window and then say show view and then say what? Servers. See, in the same position, just after properties, you will have servers. Create. See, when you are defining a new server, I have already a server defined. I have created a server. Okay. You just have to say in that and select the server type. You say, okay, let me start from the beginning. Say, let's say I do not have this server. I close it. How do you close it? I close it by saying close project. Everything is a project. Now it is closed. If it is closed, I cannot restart it. I cannot start it. See, it is closed. Okay, fine. Now, if that is so, let me create this thing. You can go to on the left hand side on the navigation bar. On any empty place, you say right click, you say new. Just follow the steps. You go to other. Is it a project? No. Is it a file? No. Is it a folder you are going to create? No. Is it an SQL file? No. Is it a JAX RS resource? No. Is it an example file? No. It is an other thing. Like, doesn't match. So I go to here. In this filter, wizard's filter, you type server. You select this. Because this is a server. Whatever server, it's a web server. You want to install a web server, fine. Not install, you want to configure because the Tomcat you have already installed, fine. Next. Now, what is the type of the server? You know, it is a Tomcat server. And what is a Tomcat server? It is provided by Apache group of development. So Apache people have given you Tomcat server. And as I said, there is server 9 as well, 10 as well. Okay, 10 is also there. But it is fine if you say 8.80. Or if you say version 9, fine. You say next. Okay. Now, I have already created a project called Devashish JSP Servlet, but maybe you have also created and therefore you wanted to create a server as well. So if you have this, just add it. Add it that because you want this server, this new server, that Tomcat server to work on this project. So this project has an associated server. And then you click on finish. So your project, which is a web project, now will have a support of Tomcat web server. Do you agree? Any questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes, now you can say no, sir. But when you try to do yourself, you might get a problem. So I will again repeat. If it is needed for you to note down, please note down. So on the left hand side, suppose you do not have anything servers, you have created, okay, I have not shown you how to create a web project. See, anything like in Java also, whatever you have done as Java files .java, you have created Java project, any one project. Under that project, you have some folder structure and this and that, source, build, src, build. And also you have packages under SRC. So similarly under build, you will have packages. So all the classes will be stored under the build according to the package. And all the Java files, the source files will be under SRC. here in a web project, you do not have exactly the same way. You have something different, the structure of the folders. It depends on what type of project you are doing. You are not creating a Java project. You are doing a, let me create a, let me first of all close it. Close the project. So in this, you are seeing everything is closed. Now, earlier in our Java classes sessions, we were using the Java code, Devashish Java code. That was the project. Right? But everything is closed now. I will create a Java, not a Java project, but something of a web project. What you do? You go to new. Will you go to project? What will project do? Will it create a Java Enterprise Edition project or a web project or a Java project?
Web project.
Huh?
Web project.
Web project. Okay. If I go to Java, create a Maven project. Okay. Where will you go? Here? Or?
Java Enterprise Edition.
Java Enterprise Edition. Which one? This one. But yes. Which one will you do? Enterprise application project or connector project or application client project or utility project? Like earlier, you know, we have mentioned client server project. So I'm client server architecture. But here you are not doing client server architecture for a Java Enterprise Edition. What do you want to do? Maven project is also a Maven project, but it is similar to Java project. Will you come to web? Which one will you select?
Static web project.
Why static? We are also trying to do something with the servlets. We are learning servlets. So don't you think it should be a dynamic? Will it not be a dynamic? Otherwise, you will not be able to use servlets. The utilities, the jar files. Sorry. The utilities such as the of the servlets, like the HTTP servlet and all those stuff will not be available if you are using static web page. It's a generic, very generic. And also you will not like to create a web fragment project. We have to create a dynamic web project. Okay, let us come to other. Other, we have a SAR project. First of all, go to this. Let us again click here on some empty place. We go to new. This we have seen project. What about other? You say web. You see? See, these are all web projects, CDI web project, context and dependency injection. This will be done when you are doing something on the Spring Boot. Okay, you do not select this because this is not a CDI web project. Or this is, we are not using JBoss. We are using Tomcat. And it is also you are not doing it over the Unix. Okay, you are doing it over the web, on the Windows and web, where you have installed Tomcat. So go to this dynamic web project. Once you do that, you say next, right? You have selected this dynamic web project and you say next. Are you able to see the screen? Okay,
yes, sir.
Take it up. you first of all give a name to the project, whether it's a dynamic web project or any Java, simple Java project. Doesn't matter. You have to give a project name. Let's say, servlet. Better to give like that, anything like that. Now you can use a default location or you can browse a location. If you want to give a customized location, that is particular location that you want to, because you might not always use the Eclipse workspace. It is also, I will not prefer you to use this. Always give a customized web location where you want to print the project, a particular directory. Okay. But for the timing, I'm saying just to show you. Now, what is the target runtime? In the target runtime, you will have, because you have already installed Tomcat and you will get Tomcat 9. And because also the thing is, that you have selected dynamic web project under other under web. So it is not JBoss or Red Hat or something else. You have used a dynamic web project under web. So it is by default, it will be Tomcat 9 because you have installed this. Or you may go for a new runtime. If you are not interested with Apache Tomcat, you can go for a new one. Let's say you want to go for Red Hat or you want to go for IBM WebSphere. Not needed, because I'm interested to work on a web server, any web server, but I'm interested mostly into a Tomcat. So I have gone and selected this one, but already this one I have selected earlier. So no need to do it again. So what you have done, just select which one you want to have. Apache Tomcat version 9.0 and dynamic web module. Always go for the last module. Version 4.0, correct? Version 4.0 is the latest one. Dynamic web module version. Now configuration. Configuration, you go to, do not go to Java server pages because you are Java server faces. Not. You are using Tomcat as a web server. That's all. This you can leave empty. You go to next. And you are saying that I'm very happy to use whatever provided by the main structure. This is the structure of any source code. SRC main Java. So whatever you are writing the servlets for the dynamic web project, you will be storing all the servlets under main Java source, main Java. Or if you want to have your own, you can specify your own folder. But always better for maintainability, for maintenance, you always go by the default one. That is the suggested one, like this. Okay. And default output folder, where your output, that is the servlet, will be compiled into classes, because servlets are nothing but Java files. So all the classes will be stored under build classes. Okay. Next. What is the web module? The context root. I have given a project name as servlet project, right? And remember, we have said that there is a deployment descriptor. And that is the main thing, because for the servlets, you have to configure that deployment descriptor, web.xml. And for that, this project needs to understand where the project deployment descriptors are stored. Always keep the same thing as suggested here. Do not change this. Source, main, web app. And you click on this. By default, there is a default WebEx web.xml deployment descriptor. Once you do, you finish it. So what I have done, I have kept the project path, the project name as the same as the context root. That is the root. And the content directory, content is the web app. So all the content, like whatever the JSP or index.html, all will be stored under web app along with web.xml. Understood? So do not try to change this. Once you are done, and generate the web.xml deployment descriptor. So that web.xml deployment descriptor, it will create by default and store it under web app. We will see that. Finish. Now you see that something is being done over here. It is done. Done. You see, this is a sublet project. I opened it. Okay, expanded it. Are you seeing that there is, it is not at all similar with what we have when we created projects in Java code. There is some additional things, some web services, JAX and WS web services. Web services are there. It is, you do not have to, you, it is just you have created the project. That's all. Everything, deployment descriptor and everything has been given by when you created, you started creating the project, web, dynamic web project. You see, you have a source, because you have said that I want to keep source main Java. Now it is empty because you have not created anything. And also you have configured the Apache Tomcat, all these jar files. Can you see? These are jar files for the web server, not anything else. These are all Tomcat utilities, jar files. Are you able to see? So that libraries and everything for the Tomcat will be automatically included whenever you are creating a project, which is a web dynamic web project. And there is build. You have not created anything. And there is source. Main Java, of course, you have nothing, no sublets created, so there is nothing, empty. But under the web app, you have also mentioned that I want to have a web container content folder, and that is the web folder, which is very important. Manifest file, you do not worry about all this thing. Just it is mentioning whatever the manifest is. But the most important directory is the web INF, web dash in capital letters. You expand it. There are lib, we have not created anything, any libraries or anything. And as well as there is one file you have said that I want the wizard, the web dynamic web project wizard, to create the web XML for me. You have clicked on the checkbox, right? So I go here, I click on it. You see, this is already done. This is already done for you. What you have to do, see, these are all done by you. There is, this is the sublet project. Under this, it is assuming that you will create index.html or index.html. So you can just simply take away this, because you have not created anything like this. Fine. You can take out all this. After that, you see immediately the error has gone. Taking this as your input of learning for today, you understand that you have created a web XML, empty web XML file. Fine. So whatever within that display name is also fine. Display name is servlet project. That means you, this project. the project that is your project you have done. Basically, you have given one tag, web app, and closing it web app. You know, as you have a bit of idea on the HTML tags. So this is one of the HTML tags, web app. Basically, this is an XML file.
Yes, sir.
So XML tag, web app is one of the user defined. It is default XML tag, web app, because you are developing a web application. So up to this, you have learned. Can I remove this project? Because I have already a project built for you. I will just.
Yes, sir.
Remove this project. So you understood. I want to delete the contents of this project on the, from the disk as well. So I will say, okay. I will continue. So that project has gone. I've removed that project. I've created just for your learning that how do you create it. So will you remember how we created the project? Either you can go to project or you can go to other. I will say you go to other. That is because try to do the things in an expert way from the very beginning. Project, if you go to project, what is happening? The same thing. But you might not know. So is it Tomcat or you have to go through the entire thing? Java project, is it a Java project? No. Is it a general project? No. Is it CDI project? No. Eclipse modeling EGB? Is it a Java project? No. Is it a Java EE project? You will say, you will go there and say no. And then you are, and you got it. Yes, it is a web project. And within that web project, I'm creating a dynamic web project. But for this, you have to browse it. But if you're an expert, you directly go here, you know that I want to create something other. I want to create a web project. And I know it is not a JBoss. It is not Red Hat Central. It is web. So it's very fine. It is in within seconds, you are getting this. Isn't it better? So remember, when for this timing, you are doing a dynamic web project. Then this will be in spring. In spring, it will change some other project, spring type of project, spring project. So we are not going to use a web dynamic web project. Okay. But here, because we are learning servlets and JSP, we will be using a project which will use servlets. So we will use servlets through dynamic web project. Correct? I think you will be able to set up a project. Once you set up a project, the next requirement is to set up the server. You have installed Tomcat server. Now you have mentioned with when you have created the other project, web, and you say dynamic web project. You have already said that I am going to use Apache Tomcat. Maybe because you have already installed Tomcat, but the next step, so you have configured all these things. The next step is you have to go and create a server. So again, go to the other. Go to server. And once you say server, you select this. Because now you want to create a web server of Tomcat. So go to next. Select Apache. You're following, no?
Yes, sir.
Nobody is saying something, anything. So I thought maybe you are following it correctly. So you just say, you select the Tomcat server and next, and the way we have seen. Okay. And finish. Why we are not getting the JSP, that Devashish JSP sublet, any server, any project here? Because there is no open project anywhere.
So we are closed.
So everything is closed. Correct. That's the reason. So if there is a current project, open project, you will associate that project with Tomcat server. That is everything. Once you do that, immediately you will see that there is servers created. Servers project. This is a project created and under which you have configured Tomcat server. Now, once you open it and you go to servers, you will see that this is stop. But you open the project. Can you see here? It is building the project, 0%. And it has completed. So now, see, this is the web dynamic web project. And you see the perspective? Perspective has shifted to Java EE because it is under Java EE. It is enterprise edition. And now you can go here or go here and you can say, I want to, because it is already configured, it is stopped, I want to start. Now you will be able to open the, start the server. As I said, it will shift from servers to console because it is letting you know that whether there is any problem or it has started. Yeah, it has started the org.apache.catalina.startup.catalina.start. Catalina is the Tomcat. It's the name of the server, Catalina server. Is it fine? Now, how will you justify that the Tomcat is running? What you do, simply go to can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you just go to localhost because now you have not, it is in your laptop only. You have installed your Tomcat in the laptop. It is not in a separate server, right? So localhost colon, let me tell you, 8080 is the port. As I said, any web server or any application server will have many services requested. Okay, so that application has to, or that web, the Tomcat is also an application. It has to be started on a server port. Here, the localhost is the server, but it similarly will have a, it is considered as a server. If your laptop is considered as a server, your localhost is the server, name of the server. And 8080 is the server port, service port, where Tomcat has started. We will see where Tomcat has started. But if you say this, once you press enter, you will see that it is saying Tomcat 9.0.5, that is Tomcat 9 has been started. Because you have started Tomcat 9 over here. This Catalina has started. Okay? But this is an assurity. This is giving you a confirmation that Apache Tomcat is installed and configured correctly. You can invoke it through localhost and with a port 8080 of your machine. And the request resource slash is not available. That is something else. Okay. But you are sure that this one has been done. Suppose you, if you can open it, can you close it? You have started this. Can you stop this? Yes, right click on it. Go to stop. It will be stopped. Now, again, go to localhost. The site cannot be reached. Why?
We are just closed.
This service is closed. This service which through which the Tomcat is running, that service itself closed. No service is running over 8080. What, instead of, this is a domain name. What can I write instead of, if I write in an IP address? As I was mentioning that you mentioned the IP address of the server where your Tomcat is installed. So what is the IP address of the local host? Anyone?
Hey, 8033.
80?
33.
No, I'm not talking about the port. I am talking when you say local host, it is the name of the server. Because you know the name of the server, which is here, it is localhost. What about if I have to indicate through a IP address? Because in many of the cases, you will need to mention IP address. Because if the server is on the cloud or the server is separate, not in your laptop. Tomcat is not in your laptop, but is installed on a Unix server, which is hosted on the cloud. And that server has an IP address. So local host also has an IP address. If you're not sure, did you have encountered this 127.0.1? There will be four IP address bitlets. Okay. So what are the bits? 127 is 1.0.11. Is it correct? Let me see. Okay. If you are not sure, you say to Google. Ask Google. .0.1. Okay. It is not 127.0.1.1. So what you do is, instead of localhost, you say 127.0.0.1 and the port number 808. Will it again call this? Sorry. 127.0.0.1.8080. You want to invoke that site, but that site is not yet, it is not running. Just 1 minute. So what is happening here? The site is not reached, but let's say you go here and you say servers, you want to start it. The Tomcat server, you want to start it. Once you start it, you will immediately see that this has changed. Server startup. You see the Catalina start. So it is successfully started up. Now you go there, you refresh it. You will see that Apache Tomcat 9.0.50 is there. Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
404 not found, because this slash is not found, because you have not given anything. You have not written anything on this Apache. Nothing has been done. Okay. So can you say that I can replace it, the local host, with an IP address? Yes. I will give you a task to find out the IP address of your machine. What will you do? You will simply go there. Say IP config. Oh, it is not standing there. So what you do, you just say command and you say IP config. Just one second. So here you are going to get your IP4v4 address. So this is your IP address of this machine. If somebody asks you how to find your IP address of your machine, because your machine is also connected, it has an Ethernet card. So it is a unique device all over the world. This IP address is only being used by your laptop or this thing. Nobody can use this one. Because two devices cannot have the same IP address. So you can rest assured that 192.168.29.105 will not be matched anywhere in the world. Okay, this is the gateway. So, okay, you were trying to find out what is your, you say ping. Local host. So you can ping, that is the local host is active. Or if you say ping 127.0.0.1, you can see reply from 127.0.1. It is fine because it is your host. Packet send 4, packet receive 4. Okay. So this is your local host. Yes, this will differ. This will not be the same. But this local host IP address will be the same everywhere, in every laptop, in every desktop. So you can use safely. This is the local host domain. You do not need to mention here. Will you, if you say you want to mention this one, I open a notepad and type this one. Okay. And here I go. Will it work or not? I will just trying to find out. I'm saying I have this IP address. You see, I'm getting the same result. So either you explicitly mention your IP address of this, your laptop, because here you have installed 808, the Tomcat, or better, you might not always remember this one. So better to say localhost or 127, because you always will know that. Same thing, same effect. Or if you want me to say this one, :8080, yes. This is again, because you are, so you can verify that whichever way you want to do. Your concept should be clear, that either you mention the IP address of your machine and with a colon, separated by colon, 8080 port. That is, you want to invoke, open the service which is running on 8080. So service is running. It is already running. You see? Oh, sorry, sir. You go to server. Your server, it is saying that it is already running. Okay, if it is running, then I can represent this with my local IP address, or I can say 127.0.0.1, the same result, or I can say, you must remember this. You must understand this. Local host, this one. The same result. Fine. Any confusion?
No, sir.
Huh?
No, sir. No.
Okay. So if that is so, let us go to Yeah. So here we have covered page 3 and Eclipse and Tomcat setup on Windows. Okay, we have done that, I think. So let's go there. And here we have said, yeah, we have completed this. We have installed Tomcat. We have configured Eclipse to have Tomcat. We knew how to create a project, dynamic web project, as well as we knew how to create a server as a Tomcat server and configure over Eclipse. All these things we have done. Now, 4. You have already done that. Okay. We have also discussed about this one, that how will you create a web project in Eclipse? You have done file, new, dynamic web project, project name, project location, target runtime, installation, Tomcat version installed, dynamic web module version, select the latest version 4.0 for servlet. Okay. Next. Click on the generate web. Yeah. Web.xml deployment descriptor. You must click it and finish it. So you know that the project folders will be your web app. One of the most important directory is the web app folder under source main. And under source main Java, if you see, it is the all the servlet sources will be stored there. Under build classes, you will put in all the class files, the compiled one. Here in web app, you have meta-inf and web-inf. Web-xml is one of the most important file. So Java resources, you have the source main Java. It is the Java sublet source code path. Creating a web page displaying hello world. Achha. Now let us create a hello world. Like we want to create an HTML file. Okay. And through that HTML file, we are requesting this. We will request the web server or the web browser to display the hello world. Okay, let's see. We are going to create an index HTML page under web app folder. Where? Under web app. So let's start our first project. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, where is the web folder? Under main, under web app. Okay. For your benefit, and we do not want to lose much of time, we have created this index.html. Now, how will you create an index.html? You go to this one, web app. Okay, because under web app, you want to create that HTML file or JSP file, whatever. What you do? You go to this, under web app, under web in. You go there under web app. Okay, folder. Under folder, you want to create your JSP or HTML or whatever. What will you do? You want to create an HTML file. So you go to new, say HTML file. And see automatically this web app where you want to create. And you say, I want to create my first index.html. This is just a name. But index by default has a meaning to the web server. That's why it's better to start. 1 minute. Hello. You're speaking. No, actually, I'm in a session right now. I'm doing training for some batch. Okay, fine. Not really. Thank you. So here you can give this. You say just give a name to an HTML file. You do not need to do anything over here. You just use an HTML template. So this template, because you do not need to write many things, you just have to say that I want to have this template HTML5 template, and just say finish. You see the doc type and HTML, the doc exclamation doc type HTML, HTML head, meta character cat set, ISO this much, title, insert title here, head, body, this structure, interstructure is automatically given by them by using that template. Similarly, and I am just now trying to remove it because I have already done it. You see, I have created an index.html the same way I have created my first index. So index.html, you see that all these things are done. Here, in the title, you have given the title, whatever the title. This is the HTML tag, title, and you close the tag by slash. I understand you already know that. You give some description, or this is, we will see that how, where will you see the title, okay? Then you close the head. So the head contains the meta character. See, if you index, if you do the control shift I, now you see there is some meaning. Okay, there was some indentation problem. Okay, so you see that the HTML starts and HTML, so the entire thing is within the HTML tag. And within the head close, you have this defined. And then comes the body. The body is the last part. And within that, you are trying to print hello world, right? This is the simple thing that I have done. Now, okay, here what we are doing is we are printing hello world on a web server, on a web browser, sorry. So what you can do is, You have started the server, fine, doesn't matter. You go to run and run it on the server. You see that there is a hello world, and what you are seeing is localhost 8080, device is JSP servlet index.html. Right? So you are printing the hello world. And you see that first web page, this is the title. This is the title. See, you have said the title is first web page. This is the title. Any confusion over here? So do you see that is it a static page or a dynamic page? If I may ask you. We will go to this page again. Now, this index.html that we have done here, index.html, is it a static page or a dynamic page?
Static page.
It is a static page because you have directly written it something over onto the server itself. There is a server which is already running. And whenever you do something like this without any call for a servlet, without any call for a servlet, just 1 minute. We will consider that this has not taken any trouble to trouble the web container because it is not using any web container at all. Because there is not calling any servlet, because this index.html is a static page in the server. In the server. Now, in this case, our server is our laptop only. So we have created one index.html on the server itself in this particular path. Yeah, it definitely needs to be under web app. That's all we have maintained. We have given the structure. We have maintained the structure as well. So the browser knows how to interpret that. The JavaScript knows the HTML5 within the, because you have used HTML tags. So it is following some HTML5 tags. It knows how to display it over the browser. It does it. It does it. Run on the server. Yes, you are taking the help of the server. You are taking the help of the server, but at the same time, you are just displaying the page which is already stored in the server. That is in your laptop, in a particular folder. Because you have created that folder. Can you see this folder structure? Is it visible on the screen?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Ha, ha, ha.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, sorry. I've not heard it. So here you will see that under web app, there is an index.html. Index.html. Isn't it the same the way what we have written over in the ID? because it is already present as in this particular folder. It has been created, and once you try to run it on the server knows, Tomcat knows where to find this file. It goes here, it checks for the file name index, and it displays it because you have stored it in the server itself. Let's say this is the server folder. D colon Devashish GBS JSP servlet training source main and web app. It is finding and it is displaying it. It knows how to display it. Okay. Any questions? Tell me if I stop this server. If I stop this server, stop. There is some noise. Okay. Now, I have stopped the server. Will it run? Will it run? If I run it, on the server. See, simply what it does, it was stopped by you, but now you see the server has already started. Once you try to run that static page or dynamic page, even if the server, your Tomcat server or the web server is down, or not, it is stopped. It will automatically, first of all, start it, then only run here. So that means this diagram is true. This diagram, so whatever request you send it from the client to the browser, to the server needs to, first of all, run the web container, which is Tomcat here. Even if it is not asking for a sublet to be run, but still, it needs a web server to interpret or process the request. Now, web container or the Tomcat, when it sees that the request is simply for a request of a static page, it will just display whatever is requested. It will display hello world. And it will package that response into as an HTML page and put it there into the client. Let's see here. Can you see that the source is nothing but that HTML source? So basically, it has interpreted the entire HTML code and it has just displayed the hello world. It knows how to do that, the Tomcat. Okay. Any questions? You already know all these things.
No, sir.
No question. Very good. So let us proceed to the next one. I have seen that the static page request is processed by Tomcat. Even if it is down, it will make it up itself up and then process that request and throw the response back to the client with the static response. Now there is a dynamic response. Shall we do the dynamic response today or you are too tired?
Sir, can you make it tomorrow?
Tomorrow I will be having some other session, some with some other batch. Okay. So let me just introduce you to a dynamic one.
Okay.
Here we have something very dynamic. What we are saying that similarly, I have created an index1.html page like the one we have done creating an HTML page. You go to web app, you say new HTML file, right? You can create that. That means this structure will be already there for you. What you are doing, you are just printing this as a title, Y servlet, fine. And the rest body, you have done it fully yourself. What you have done? That you have given a form. A form, these are all HTML things. You must know that form is a tag. And within that tag, there is a property called action. And that action, what action you are doing? This add is very important within double quotes. You are saying, I'm doing some addition. It's a function. You can say it's a function. It's all a function is a service, nothing but a service. And this one is a comment, you know. How do we invoke a comment in this one? You can either type in or you can say control. Just 1 minute. Sunil. Okay. Okay, fine. Okay, fine. Sure. তাহলে কালকে করা যাবে so you can use, see, this is a comment, like in Java you do a comment like //. Here you cannot do because it's a HTML form, HTML page. What you do in any web page, if you want to do any comment, you press, let's say you want to comment it, okay, you press control shift and a front slash. Earlier in Java, if you say control shift front slash, there will be a double tag for the entire block. But here if you block this part, you want to do this part only. So what you say, control shift and backslash, you see the entire this tag has been commented. This is a shortcut way, but anyway, what I'm saying is form action add. This action is invoking a function called add. And within that function, within that form action function add, I am saying that I am displaying enter first number colon input. It is another, you must know HTML. I understood, assume that you know HTML. So a basic idea of HTML will also help. Just I'm using very basic. So one HTML input tag will help you to input a value into a field. That field is a text field. And the name of the field is, whatever the variable you are sending is or typing, that will be captured in num1. So num1 is one request parameter, you can say, and num2 is one another request parameter. And this function add, I want to do something, but before that I want to submit this. That means I'm trying to request this, the entire request parameter, request string, I'm giving it to the servlet. First, I will try to run whether this comes or not. So what I will do, I will try to run this, or I can just pick up this. Let me save it. I can do this way, or I will just simply say run as on a server. So see, can you see that there are two fields? Enter first number, enter second number, enter second number, and whatever you see here is the text field. Once I mentioned you that whatever you type from the keyboard onto a web web screen is all in strings. So you say 67 plus 78. Whether it's a plus or minus or subtraction doesn't matter. You try to submit this. Can you see that you are invoking 8080 Divashish GSP? This is a project name or the, you know, the context root. Remember, you have said the context root as Divashish Sublet while you created the project. Remember, you have given one option, Divashish dash sub, JSP sublet as a context root. So that context root is coming here. And what are you doing from that? You are invoking index.html. Index1.html. So index1.html is this one, and it gives this. Once I do submit query, once you do the submit, what it does, it goes to the form, it tries to execute the form and goes to the action add. Let's see. I say I submit query. Okay. What it did, now, you see the request resource, Devashish JSP sublet is the context root. Are you finding index1.html? No. It is trying to call the form action, which is add. Add is a service, add is a function. But did we create any function? Did we say that what we want to do through this function name?
No, sir.
We did not. So it is failing. It is giving a HTTP, that is 404, page not found. What page? That add sublet. It is a sublet, it is a function, it is a service that is calling. But the Tomcat is not finding that because you have not created it. Where do you want to create it? That link. Now that is the requirement when you use to, because see, today you have given this one. I can just go back and say refresh. Refresh. I can give 45 and 45 or 4. Similarly, so it is dynamically changing, but who is serving me? Suppose my intention was to submit it with an addition. I want to add these values. So 45 plus 5 is 50. I want to get a result 50. But did I do anything for that? Did I create any sublet to help me with this service? That's why you need sublet. It is not the question of static page. You are not only inputting this one. You want to find a result. You are inputting this, fine. But at the same time, you want to submit and find a result. But who will process your query that you wanted to add? Where is the add function? Anyone? Will you be able to do this? Like, let's say in this HTML page, I want to take the input from the user, num1 and num2, and also give a function for add. Will HTML be able to help me with that? HTML can display the static pages.
No, sir. I think it should be right in the Java.
I can write result is, I have given a, let me give a break. Okay. Break means I just give a line gap. The result is, how do I know what is num1 and num2? Can I do this num1 plus num2? Is it acceptable? I don't know. Let's see. Okay. I will again run it. Fine. I can always run it. Running is not a problem. You see, it is displaying a static thing. I have not yet given anything because it doesn't know that num1, it's just a string. But my question was, I want to add 5 with 55 or 55 with 67. Yes, then I submit a query. I should get a result of 572, 122. Right? I should have got 122. But I'm getting an error. So how will we solve this problem? This why servlet, you see, that title has come. That is fine. But I'm not being able to get the result. So to get that result, what I'm trying to do is, or let me say HR. I would like to give a horizontal line. Now for that, what I have done is I have gone to Java. I have gone to this particular package. I have developed a servlet, which is a Java. I have said add servlet.java. Now this portion I will discuss on the next class. Because now we are understanding why we need a servlet. We cannot do it over a static page. This portion we have understood, right? Another thing is we have to understand is that the very important part called WebXML. See, I have created a WebXML with the web app and this one. The rest portion I have added. So last one is web app. So these two tag was given whenever I was creating the project. Here, I would like to have something like remember, we said something earlier is we said that there is something called a combination of servlet tag and a servlet mapping. Here we said that there is in WebXML, we have two tags. One is servlet and the other one is servlet mapping. The combination of two will determine to web container, that is Tomcat, that I am trying to get the service of a particular servlet. Here, that particular servlet, what I'm saying that I am trying to use a tag servlet and a servlet mapping. In servlet, what we are saying, under servlet, we have another tag, child tag called servlet name. These are all defined earlier. So in XML. So we say servlet name as addition and servlet class as com.pcsglobal.addServlet. So add servlet is this one. Is the name of the Java file. So this is the class. Add servlet is the class. So servlet will have servlet name and servlet class. What is the servlet mapping tag? Has the child servlets as servlet name. I have to mention that the servlet name should be the same. This servlet name will have a reference to this class. And this URL pattern, because you cannot mention for security reason, you cannot mention the server, the servlet name in the URL. So you are representing the URL as an alias to this class. Are you getting me? And what is this add? This add is nothing but in index.html, you are mentioning this add as a function. This service you are trying to call, and this service will be provided by add servlet class. And add servlet, you have created your add servlet. Name of a Java file, a servlet file. It is not an ordinary Java file, it is a servlet file, because it is extending HTTP servlet. Today, I will stop here. Oh, let me execute this, because I have done some changes that you will see that I'm being able to dynamically. Yeah, so I will invoke this. I want to execute this add servlet, which I have already created. And I am calling this URL add. So you see, now I go here, index.html, and I will run it again. I have done some changes in web.xml. So this server will be stopped and again started. Now I have given an HR. HR means horizontal line. So you are finding two HRs. And I am now trying to print 22 plus 45. And I will say submit query. Do you see the result? Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen?
No, sir.
Yes, sir.
I couldn't
see. So are you happy that you have got something at least to be displayed on the screen?
Yes.
You have seen the result is 67. I have not calculated. No, I have let that servlet function create it or calculate it. That is the beauty. You change it. You go there. You change the value. It becomes 62. Can you see it? So today we will stop here. I think is enough for today, first day. Do you agree? I will stop share. Are you fine with whatever we have learned today?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear a bit?
Yes, sir. I have to practice
that. Asharya, Rajshekhar, Himanshu, Kundan, Ashish, Arnab. Any response? No response?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So I'm closing the recording today and closing the session today.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Asharya.